new Joe Catenacci.
The torch has been passed.
If he says great things about me, I'm going to say great things about him.
I have no doubt that he's an unwitting agent of the Russian Federation.
I mean, the man has very strong control.
It is scary.
I can imagine, at least in the early stages, flattery, complimenting him.
Joe Catenacci.
We want a real meeting with a real agenda. This ain't Miss America, this is America.
Government is not the solution to our problem. Government is the problem.
Joe Catenacci.
77 degrees here in the port city, high at 84, cloudy the forecast today, increased rain chances, isolated thunderstorms in the forecast moving through this afternoon, tonight, into tomorrow, and really through the rest of the week, and you know, not too often we're going to talk about wanting the rain and the nasty weather, but that being said, in need of some precipitation here in our area. We'll leave the severe stuff for another day, but let the rains fall, if they may, here today. We are 24 minutes in front of the hour. Yaël Ossowski with the Consumer Choice Center joins us here this morning. Our conversation is brought to you by GRA Maven, the veteran-owned and operated security company providing the best in-breed security solutions and training. Their mission, provide a full-spectrum security consulting process to you, many corporate clients, many diplomats that they protect all around the world, and they are based right here in Wilmington. Contact GRA Maven today at gramaven.com. That's GRAMAVEN.com. Yaël, it's great to have you back on the program, and I hope you've been well. I know you were in the swamp just recently, so hopefully you were able to take a shower, hose off, and ready to go and join us here this morning.
Yeah, Joe, thanks so much. I fortunately brought my hazmat suit, so the swamp is off me, and had a great time in D.C.
All right, well, a lot of our politicians from both sides of the political aisle, and we heard Nancy Pelosi being the latest to kind of come out and want to slap regulations and government interference on the way the internet works, and you have an op-ed in the Detroit Free Press talking about how it's in your belief that, yes, we should be holding these platforms such as Facebook, Twitter accountable. But, let's not necessarily go as far as wanting the centralized, ever-powering and federal government to determine, where we can go. In fact, yesterday, on the other side of the world, in a place called China, they, in fact, did something like that and basically have rid the internet, state-owned internet, by the way, in China, of certain key words to kind of obstruct people from viewing something that occurred 30 years ago, like a massacre where thousands of people were killed. So, that may be a slippery slope and an extreme, but it's a good example, I think, of where the government can go if you give them an inch.
Yeah, and I think that's the bigger issue that we see here is, there's a lot of people who have very good intentions who want to rein in the big social media platforms. A lot of conservatives as well. There's conservatives and liberals both. They each have their own agenda, and the idea is they want to bring in big tech and hopefully whip it until it follows their whim. But the issue with that, as we all know, is that the more powerful the government gets and the more rules and regulations that are passed, it's only the big dogs that are going to be able to actually comply with all this regulation, and you're really going to give these companies even more of a monopoly. So the idea that we need to have more regulation, that we need to have some kind of oversight committee of the internet run by elected senators or congressmen, I mean, this should scare everyone. There's a reason the internet is so free now. There's a reason that billions of dollars have been created in GDP from everything that's happening online. It's what consumers want. It's what people want. Do we want to have the same governmental advisors, ministers, people working in different bureaucracies or even elected people? Do we want these people to be the ones who can kind of champion and chief and referee everything that we put online? I think most people would say a resounding no to that.
With that being said, often and with this, as many things, comes a personal responsibility to wade through the news or some of the things that you may view through some of these social media giants, the Facebooks and the Twitters. And with that said, there's personal responsibility that comes with this. And oftentimes, I'll just play devil's advocate here. It's just people will say, well, you don't like it, get off of it. Well, there's not really many competing platforms, as particularly for conservatives. Conservative-minded or leaning people in my mind. So, what's the advice that you can give to somebody that may feel disenfranchised? I mean, look, I utilize Facebook and Twitter, and there's no other way for me to connect through social media other than these platforms. But I often at times get frustrated with the fact that, I see stuff that pops up from 4 or 5 days ago. The algorithms that they use change. I don't necessarily see maybe a news article that I would click on. I see many news articles that make me want to pull my hair out of my head. So, how do you go about talking to those consumers about how you can kind of, wade through this without, lending an idea that the government, may be better suited to control this?
So I think there's two ways to answer that question. The first is to use the existing platforms and use the thing like a list that you have on Twitter or the groups on Facebook. You can find people to discuss topics and debate certain things, or maybe it's just for your family. You can do that within the existing platforms today. I think if people are able to segment their audience a little bit better, you wouldn't have a lot of these issues, and you wouldn't have people always calling to ban this or that person. So the deplatforming is an entirely different issue, but still very important. And the second answer to that is there are alternatives. There are different social networks that I hope people get on. There's a great new one called Decentr. It's actually an application put together by the guys at Gab. It's seen as the alt-right network, but really we're seeing that a lot more people are coming onto that. It's just a decentralized approach to kind of the Twitter and Facebook monopolies that exist today, at least in the eyes of many people. But there are alternatives out there, and that's the greatest thing about the Internet is that they exist and they're there, and we're free to choose them. We're not limited in just two or three boxes, and I think that's great for everyone. So I definitely would recommend Decentr. I think it's great. Reddit is also very good. There's tons of people on there. Great information. You don't have to just look at the big three or the big two. There's plenty of opportunities out there. People should be able to empower themselves, put their own internet servers together, build their own communities. All those tools are out there. Many things are open source, and I think many more consumers and a lot of your listeners may be very interested in learning more about that.
Well, I think that's where we can go with this, in that I think many people out there just don't have that information and education and maybe a wherewithal on how to utilize some of these platforms even more deeply, particularly maybe the older generations that get on these sites for the first time, rather than, of course, maybe a younger guy like myself or our producer, Nick Craig, who knows all of these platforms that you just labeled right there, is just nodding his head to me across the window pane. So maybe it's just more of an educational, part of this that we need to get out to the public to show them that the alternatives are out there, or the way to maybe utilize some of these, bigger platforms in a different way other than just the, kind of the rudimentary way.
Yeah, and I think people need to have diversity in their lives when it comes to not only ideas, but also the platforms and the kind of systems that you're using. I obviously would, as kind of a consumer advocate, say that the more that you can hold your data close to you, it's always better. That's more personal advice than what government regulation should be. I certainly don't think the government will do a better job. But if you're able to hold it close together, if you're able to use more decentralized services, another one is Mastodon. That's a more decentralized Twitter where people set up their own servers. You can follow and comment and debate, and it's all free speech. There's no banning. There's something beautiful there. And again, people can find this. People can use different search engines and find these different networks. I'm on many of these, so if you Google my name, you'll find many of them there. But yeah, the more alternatives that people use, the more that people are willing to vote with their feet and use different platforms, the better platforms we're going to get. And that's why the market overall is way better than overregulation.
Yaël Ossowski with the Consumer Choice Center is with us here this morning. Yaël, you have a great op-ed on this that has been pushed around some of the major media outlets. How can you point our listeners towards that article? And in fact, I think you might be tapped into our internal communication here, because our producer, Nick Craig, just asked me to ask you about Mastodon and the platform. Just as that text was coming in, you started talking about it. Are you tapped into us here at the Big Talker Studios?
Yeah, you'd think I'm China or something, and I've got all the spy gear. I got the fly phone, old pap. Yeah, not at all.
Hey, all right. Tell me how folks can read more about some of your thoughts on this topic, and a relevant one, and one that has gained national attention here, really over the last year or so.
Yeah, definitely. You can just follow me on Twitter. It's very easy. Yaël Oss. I actually keep the same name for all my social media, so not just Twitter, but also on Mastodon and Reddit and all the rest. That was the article in the Detroit News. I hope people read it. Know that the answers to all of our problems are not going to come from Washington. They're going to come from us.
And no question, I think the more and more we can talk about this, the more and more people hopefully can start to see the light that getting government out of the way is a good thing when it comes to the freedoms and liberties that we should be enjoying here in the United States of America and all around the world. Yaël Ossowski with the Consumer Choice Center is with us. Hey, can you hang on a second? We'll take a break, and we want to get into this other article that you pointed towards me on social media just the other day about our American cities. We hear all about how the homelessness rate today report out from one of the local outlets in LA, up like 15%, 59,000 homeless in Los Angeles County. We know about the things that are going on in places like San Francisco, Seattle, many of our major cities. And it doesn't have to necessarily just do with homelessness. A lot of the policies that have been put in place over the years have really put many who live in metro areas in an unlivable situation, whether that be actual medieval diseases that are wreaking havoc on members of the homelessness population, or even many of our urbanized cities and those who live in those areas, how the socialist type of mindset and policies have been tried again, and we're seeing the results of this decades later. Yael's going to comment on some of these talking points when we get back here on the Big Talker FM, approaching 9 o'clock, moving into the third hour. Yaël Ossowski with the Consumer Choice Center joining us here this morning. We're going to talk about unlivable cities in America and maybe who's to blame for these conditions. We'll be back. Are 11 minutes in front of the hour here this morning. Yaël Ossowski from the Consumer Choice Center is with us. And Yaël, one of the going back to that conversation we just had a moment ago, and my producer and I were just going forward and talking about it a little bit further. The big thing is, I think the challenge, I guess, and understanding that there are alternatives out there to Facebook and Instagram and Twitter, is that for an internet tech savvy person for yourself or Nick, you may more easily be attracted to something like that. But what about my mom, for instance? She wants to upload photos, and she is inundated with that news that she may not necessarily want to, but she's looking at it every day. But she may not be as versed to technically through the web to find these types of alternative sites. And that's a big challenge there, I think.
Yeah, you always need early adopters, and then you need the followers. And I think if you have enough early adopters, you can build an audience and you make the tools easy to use, I think that's how you get more and more people. I mean, it's why these companies are now worth billions of dollars, because they found the formula that works. They found the way so that anybody can get on there. It's simple. It's easy. I think a lot of these alternatives, they just need to do the same thing. And hopefully they will. There's a lot of leaders that have migrated. I think Telegram is another great messaging app that people are using now instead of Messenger or WhatsApp. That's another one that's totally private, encrypted. It also has a very cool social networking capability. So again, these things are out there. We just need the audience. We need more people using them, more people to be skeptical, and more people to think about their privacy.
And I think that's well said in that you're right. We remember, you know, well, it's now almost 20 years, really, since Facebook kind of launched as just a, you know, a Harvard-based communication network, and what that turned into across universities. And then it opened up to the broader general population. And here we are. Now, so change doesn't necessarily happen in a day. We know that. But yeah, it takes time. And it takes, as you said, some folks and detractors to find somewhere else and then those to follow. And I think that's a point well made. Yaël Ossowski with the Consumer Choice Center with us. All right. You also posted an article from the New York Times, an op-ed just a week or so ago. The title of this op-ed, American Cities Are Unlivable, Thank Wealthy Liberals. That's the title of an article, an op-ed in the New York Times. And across the country, of course, we continue to see images of filth, trash all over our major cities. You look on those West Coast cities, San Francisco, Los Angeles, up in Seattle, was out in Seattle earlier this spring, and you know, saw some, you know, pretty tough conditions in certain areas of that city, and it is beautiful out there in the Pacific Northwest. And then you look into San Francisco, you've got the poop map, you've got LA, 59,000 homeless. That homelessness number has increased 15%, I think. I saw a report out there from KLA.com today. And then you look at New York City, for instance, and they have approached homelessness a little bit different. So we haven't seen the medieval diseases wreaking havoc among that population, but the other infrastructure, the subways are trash, and have been falling apart for decades. And all of these things have one thing in common. I think the New York Times op-ed put it perfectly clear. Thank wealthy liberals.
Yeah, and the other thing to add to that is these places are not, you know, poor, decrepit, backwards. These places are flush with cash. They got plenty of money. It's something that, you know, you or I in North Carolina were able to look around and see, you know, some pretty clean cities, great areas. If we were to have an extra 5 million people dropped on us tomorrow, you know, would the cities be able to keep up? I'm not sure. That's something that every state or city has had to deal with. California has done it exceptionally bad. In California and in the Pacific Northwest, as you mentioned, many places you're not allowed to build. You cannot have new apartment buildings. You can't have these new places where people are supposed to live and work. So when you have great innovative companies like Facebook, Google, Amazon, any others that are moving to these cities or building their headquarters, and they're going to employ 15,000 people, where are these people going to live? If they don't have the housing, then they're just going to start going outwards to the burbs, pushing out people who've been living there for decades. More people are going to be homeless. Opportunities then become more stagnant when more regulation is passed, as has happened in the super democratic state of California. I think we need to have just take a second, look at where it works. I think North Carolina is actually a pretty good example. We have a good amount of development across the state, more and more. But in states like Washington and in California, unfortunately, you just don't have that. So on the one hand, it's housing and supply. On the other, it's regulation, taxation. If you live in California and you look at your income versus living in North Carolina looking at your income, it's a huge difference. And I think everyone who lives there, and particularly the people who are now leaving California, the California refugees who are going to places like Austin or Raleigh or Charlotte, they're seeing that this has gone way too far and the experiment has likely failed on the West Coast.
When we talk about this as well, pouring money onto a problem doesn't necessarily solve the problem. We've seen that in all levels, basically every issue that we face here in this country, and that, you know, the government will tell us, well, if only we spent a little bit more money, if only you gave us a little bit more of your hard-earned cash, can we fix some of these issues? Well, in fact, we see, you know, when a city like Los Angeles, you know, ups their spending to help the homelessness problem at the tune of hundreds of millions of dollars, well, what have we seen the last year? Just a massive increase of homelessness in a place like L.A. County. So it's not necessarily, it doesn't correlate in whether it be this issue or any issue that we talk about, really, that money doesn't always necessarily solve the problem. And in fact, sometimes it makes it worse.
That's true. And if people want to go on YouTube, they can look up a great documentary called Seattle is Dying. That was put together by a local news station, I believe it's the ABC station in Seattle, that talks about all the issues there. And then also, you know, the bad solutions. They have this head tax that was passed, this idea that you're going to tax everybody living in Seattle in order to pay for the homeless. So basically, you tax the working people and the living people to give more and more money to the homeless population. That hasn't proved to work. And again, it's just another penalty on people who are just trying to get by, people who are just trying to do honest work. And it's politics not working. So it's a very good documentary. I'd recommend that to all your listeners, and just yet another example of how these beautiful places, beautiful states, while they have beautiful lakes and rivers and cannabis policies, they don't seem to do it quite well when it comes to normal regulation that affects the average worker and person who lives in that state.
Yeah, Yaël Ossowski with the Consumer Choice Center. And actually, I watched that documentary, and what I noticed was pretty telling in that it was kind of normal people who had somewhat normal lives and working class people living in those cities. Those were the people that were speaking up and were the most vocal against their public officials. And how do you, reverse that trend of electing public officials that, continue to just kind of pour fuel on the fire rather than, have somebody that's going to come up with a bold solution that's going to have to make those tough decisions to reverse this disgusting trend that we're seeing?
Yeah, and it's not even just about what are the best ideas. It's just about how do you let people who already have ideas, who already have capital, how do you let them continue to do their thing, and how do you get out of the way? There's so much more that could be done, and all you need to do is allow competition, allow building, allow better zoning laws. This is stuff that people need to be fighting for at the local city councils and at their county commissioners, because this is always local. It always stems from the local. Yes, they'll get influxes of cash from the state, but this is something to where you or I or anyone listening could actually have an impact. So always be attuned to what's happening at your city council. Always be attuned to what's happening at the county level. And if any of these issues come up, you can be the first to say, we warned you, we were there, we were present, and we were loud.
Yaël Ossowski with the Consumer Choice Center. Yaël, always a good conversation. And I think I'm going to work with you after we get done with the show here today. I want to try and bring you on maybe next week because you are well-traveled and you spend a lot of time overseas, and we're seeing an interesting trend. And we brought it up, I think, a few conversations ago related to some of the policies that are getting pushed by many of the leading Democrat candidates in our country running for president, and what we've seen in maybe some of the Scandinavian countries as far as the way we view socialism, the differences in that. And also I want to talk to you about how we're seeing a populist kind of revolt in many countries across Europe, in India, in Australia, and how that trend has kind of taken shape around the world really since the election of Donald Trump in 2016. More and more people standing up for stricter immigration policies, less migration, fighting against radical, climate change legislation. A lot of countries around the world, their people are speaking up, and we get little to no coverage of that in the American media. So you down for that conversation next week if we can make it happen?
Oh, yes, of course. I'll be phoning in from Charlotte, so look forward to it.
Awesome. Yaël Ossowski from the Consumer Choice Center. We're going to get back with him next week. This portion of the program has been brought to you by Ben Hawkins with Sierra Pacific Mortgage. Whether you are purchasing your dream home, refinancing your current home, investing in additional property, he can help find the right loan program for you. Contact Ben Hawkins with Sierra Pacific Mortgage at lendwithben.com, 910-352-3373.